I ended part one by saying I hadn't got anywhere near to attaching blame for 9/11. I spoke of how I felt for the families and their relatives and the fact their stomachs have put a new meaning to the phrase gut-wrenching. It's not so much that their elected representatives are spineless. I mean, before Mr. Yes We Can Obama warmed a White House seat, he couldn't wait to declare there was no need for a public inquiry over 9/11.
Really?
And so much for his opposition to Guantanamo Bay and the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. To him I can only say, no we can't. And no you damn well haven't. Shame on you. You had the hopes of many people, not just in America, but the whole world right there in your hands. Everyone praying you'd make the world a better place. And you blew it. You had no right to do that because you, sir, know the truth. Even if it resulted in the same fate as JFK, and it may well have, you had no right to offer so much hope. Maybe it's an impossible ask, but there really does come a time when one's life is not that important. Even the loved ones you leave behind, because you had a chance no one may ever have again. If you were prepared to take the presidency, you should have been prepared to fall on your sword. Obama and the rest aside, the victims' families may have been given false hope, but it's you, the public, who they're really pissed off with. All you folk out there who genuinely believe you can read between the lines, all those who believe the crud you've been told, should feel terribly ashamed of yourselves. And I truly hope some of my very good friends hear this, because it certainly applies. I often wonder what the victims' families think of Larry Silverstein. In case you didn't know, he owned the towers when it all went off. I've been trying to discover exactly what he paid. After 10 years, the lowest quote I found was $14 million. The highest, $60 million or so. The towers, though, were an asbestos bombshell. Any new owner would be saddled with a stipulation to replace the fireproof asbestos-lined foam which covered the steel. This could cost anywhere up to $1 billion. Other than that, quite why the Port Authority sold the towers at such a knockdown price when they cost $1.5 billion to build in the late 70s, I don't know. Since when did prime real estate prices plummet continually for 30 years? What I'm pretty damn sure about is backhanders must have been flying around all over the place. Nice bit of business, my boy. By the way, Silverstein bought the towers in 2001. What's more interesting, though, is immediately after the purchase, he began taking out just a little insurance. Oh, and before you even begin to think something seriously stinks here, I just want to tell you, Silverstein took out these policies with 24 insurance companies. 24. Usually when anyone takes out insurance, you shop around a bit and, you know, you settle for the one that gives you the best deal. If you've got the brains of a rocking horse, you take the first quote. Now, I'm not 100% sure. And you could make the odd exception where certain firms have to cover themselves or some bozo somewhere just happens to like a bit of extra cover or something. The trouble is, I worked in the insurance business for over 3 years, and in that time I never knew anyone or any firm that ever took out multiple policies. Cut a long story short, Larry got paid out. Lowest estimate I found was around $4.5 billion. Just in case you've fallen off your seat, yes, I did say billion. And the highest quote was $7.1 billion. Again, please don't think anything stinks, for the best is yet to come. Where Silverstein was just a bit too clever for my liking was he specifically stated that it required full coverage in case of a terrorist attack. That's right. How often have terrorists flown planes into buildings? Never. Oh well, you never know when the entire intelligence infrastructure of the USA can suddenly take a walk. And also, you never know when tens of thousands of the most amazing jet fighters can miraculously end up superglued to terra firma, rendering the most sophisticated air defence system in the world worthless. One final little thing. George Bush's brother, Jeb, happened to be a director in one of the major insurance firms daft enough to underwrite the Twin Towers policy. Nice bit of business, my boy. So how do you think the victims' families feel? Okay, it happened. You're the president. The mere thought may be abhorrent to you, but you're George W. Stop and think about it. What is the first thing that comes in your mind? What would be your initial response? Now, if you take this question seriously, obviously it's tough because the last thing you want is to suddenly have an almighty knee jerk. I mean, the rest of the world is looking on with bated breath, shocked at such an outrage. But they don't want to see a president behaving like Roy Rogers in the Wild West. So you think for a while at exactly what's happened. Well, a lot of people did make a lot of money out of this large hint, followed by a very large hint. Firstly, I'll tell you what actually happened. The very next day, America... Wait a minute, no. Not America. I want to be very careful here because I lived in America and it was great. I loved it, every minute of it. Everyone, I could honestly say, was as warm as hell and I never had such a good time in my life. Right, I got that straight. Not America, no. The very next day, the White House began pointing the finger at Osama bin Laden. The day before, it was all shock horror. What's happened here? US intelligence knew very little. 24 hours later, they know who's pulled the strings. Maybe, but on that basis, they could have put Santa Claus or Donald Duck in the frame. Isn't it a touch strange how the CIA, the FBI, and God knows what suddenly sprang into life? Remember too how no apology whatsoever was given, and how this geezer in a case somewhere somehow managed to concoct such an elaborate plan without anyone knowing Jack? Oh, but he was the one. He did it. Do me a favour. But how many of you people know that the very next day Osama bin Laden stated quite categorically on Al Jazeera TV he had nothing to do with the attacks? Zilch. Unfortunately for him, this broadcast was completely ignored by the entire Western media. You know, I'm actually lost for words here. And I ain't never been that yet. I mean, here's a guy accused of a most outrageous crime. For a start, the American people have a right to hear what this man's got to say for himself. For God's sake, think for a second. Aren't terrorists only too glad to admit what they've done? That's the whole point of being a terrorist, to acquire publicity in order to highlight their grievance, however absurd it may be. But how on earth is it possible that every single major TV station turns a blind eye to what is nothing short of the most sensational, groundbreaking news ever? We all heard George Bush's accusations. Hardly anyone heard bin Laden's denial. What the hell is going on here? So what would you do if you were the president? Well, if it was down to me, firstly, I'd ask Larry Silverstein to sit a lie detector test. If he was innocent, what would he have to fear? The test would conclusively prove he had no prior knowledge of the attacks. Once that's established, you move on. There should be no problem with this whatsoever. Okay, people say they're not perfect. Tell me what is. Our justice system's hardly that. In any case, after such an atrocity, with so much at stake, the whims of even the sternest critics of lie detector machines are not an issue. To refuse the assistance of another tool is sheer folly. Of course, I can see all those solicitors and those barristers, the finest trained professional lives in their cool desperation that we forever preserve and cherish our archaic methods of dealing with legal matters. For them, technology is the viral infection that, if ever unleashed, would slowly, inevitably usher in extinction. The end result? Money's capacity to conceal truth and so buy justice is dealt an almighty blow. You see, if I was the press, the minute I say to Silverstein that he's got to strap on the electrodes, if there were any stalling, any hesitation at all, and oh boy, if he were to refuse, then the biggest alarm bells in the whole wide world would go off. Quite simply, I'd say this to him. 3,500 of our citizens have just been slaughtered and you're giving me a hard time. Let me tell you something, pal. I'm pretty damn sure 250 million Americans out there want this bad. Since you made an absolute lump out of this, it's not an option. Take the test, you little rat. In any crime, if it's not a family affair, if you're any sort of detective, all you have to do is follow the money. 3 days before 9/11, the Securities and Exchange Commission informed the authorities of highly irregular trading in a particular company. Not that this is anything special, but with insider trading, people will always try and make a fast buck. Legitimate investors have to have protection. The SEC is there to watch over potential skullduggery. A 3% move here, a 4% move there. A 5% swing in any share in one day would have traders' tongues wagging. So I wonder what the authorities thought when the SEC informed them of a small matter of 400% increase in trading in American Airlines. The next day, the hemorrhaging continued, a sixfold increase. And on the 10th of September 2001, the SEC informed the authorities of an 11-fold increase in trading, all one way, south. Here's where it gets interesting. I know a little bit about this because I worked in the markets for 4 years in Geneva. I bought and sold shares, and I can say categorically, it's impossible to trade in shares. Even a small investor, without names, without addresses, without bank accounts. It's impossible. Therefore, all those that traded in the shares of American Airlines are on record. They're there. However, the Bush administration, the 9/11 Commission, chose to ignore this. Evidence that was clear-cut in identifying those who may have had prior knowledge to 9/11. And for 10 years, nobody's been able to explain this to me. What quickly became painfully obvious, though, was the 9/11 Commission wasn't worth a bar of soap. The very least that should have happened is every last person that gained financially should have been forced to take a lie detector test and be made to answer but one question. Did you have prior knowledge of the 9/11 attacks? Could it be any more farcical? Well, now we proceed from the sublime to the ridiculous. Imagine the plight of trading houses and all the layers who for the past 3 days had effectively guaranteed untold millions upon millions on put options on US airlines. One morning they wake up and all of a sudden they're watching planes go smashing into buildings. They must have thought, what the hell's going on here? We've done our absolute brains. But no, it all went quiet. The phones weren't ringing. Of course they weren't going to complain about it. I mean, how could you fathom such a thing? No one was inquiring about their winnings. Can you imagine? It's like winning the lottery. You've got the jackpot, you know it. But for some reason or another, you throw away the winning ticket. Pure unadulterated greed, and greed of the very worst kind, because how many of these vermin actually thought about informing the police or the newspapers? And vermin they most certainly are, because all who sold airline shares in the 3 days before 9/11, I grant you, enjoy a standard of living most of us only dream about. It takes hard cash to buy or sell shares. Trading on futures, i.e. calls and puts, requires big money. At the time, these people were privy to information. Information of a kind that was as unbelievable as it gets, but unbelievable as it was, they knew it was true. So they had to profit from it. Well, you can't sell shares in the stability of skyscrapers. And you can't sell shares in the number of Americans that get massacred in one day. But you can sell shares in an airline. The very fact no share transaction can be performed anonymously. The very fact the Bush administration and the 9/11 Commission inexplicably failed to pursue a line of inquiry both with Silverstein and the SEC means the official investigation, if you can even call it that, stop short in asking the most transparently logical questions, which if answered, would almost certainly have provided answers as to who really was behind 9/11. I did say in part one, people are often labelling me a conspiracy theorist. Well, think again. Because nothing of what I've said can remotely be labelled theoretical. Nothing. I'm merely asking questions that have never been answered. I'd like you to think about that. Annoying as it is, what I find so disconcerting is all those who are in denial, for the best part, can't even debate the issue. Without thinking, they dismiss what is patently obvious. Yet if you ask what their criteria is for discerning between theory and fact, they remain clueless. What really worries me is time for logical thought has long since passed.